Prime Minister Chris Hipkins has narrowed down his cabinet even further, adding justice to Ginny Anderson's ever-growing list of portfolios. It comes after Kiri Allan was arrested after crashing her car whilst intoxicated. We asked her East Coast electorate yesterday what they made of the whole affair.
Yeah, that is just totally against everything that we've ever known about her in a positive way.
I thought she was doing a fantastic job for Gisborne, but this latest one wasn't too good.
I think given what she has been through, it's been quite traumatic. It doesn't excuse what's happened, but I think she needs a lot of support.
It's going to be a tough wee while until we can find a replacement and somebody that's got the same energy and love for the community. You know, it was clear she had a love for the people and a love for Tairawhiti. So, you know, I think she is going to be missed.
Allan is now getting support that she needs, but any ministerial scandal can be tough for someone to handle, as our next guest found out all too well. Former Cabinet Minister Iain Lees-Galloway joins me now. Morena, Iain, thank you so much for being with us. God, whichever way you look at this, this is a sad, messy state of affairs.
Look, it really is. And I think that's the overwhelming feeling that people have got. They just feel sadness for Kiri and really hoping that she's got the people around her that she needs and the support that she needs. And I know she's got a lot of people who love and respect her. And they'll be getting round her at the moment and taking care of her. And that's just what she needs right now.
I mean, this was a rising star of the Labor Party who's been praised in the past for the way that she's handled her ministerial portfolios. I saw some commentators consider her as potential leadership material at some point later on down the track. So how much does this speak to those pressures that people feel once they're inside Parliament?
Yeah, Kiri was identified early as a star. I think even as a candidate, she was identified and got a lot of media attention as a candidate. There was a lot of expectation on her and she rose quickly. She was immediately one of the whips team when she came into Parliament. And that comes with a whole lot of extra pressure. Plus the fact that there's kind of an expectation that politicians live their whole lives in the public now. And I think Kiri did that. The fact that we're even able to talk about, you know, her relationship, the other things that are going on in her life outside of work, speaks to the pressure that's placed on politicians beyond just the job. And I think she wore a lot of additional pressure and a lot of additional expectation. She's a very capable person. She deserved that attention. She deserved the opportunity to rise through the ranks as quickly as she did. But, you know, Parliament's a brutal place. And that's what's really borne out here, is that constant pressure, that constant spotlight, is not something that everybody can thrive in.
That's not to excuse personal responsibility here, though, Iain, right?
Oh, no, absolutely not. Nobody thinks that it's tenable for Kiri to carry on as a minister. And it's been the same with lots of other examples. You can not excuse the behaviour. You can understand the need for someone to move on and take personal responsibility. But you can also look at the context and feel for the person as a human being. And that's sometimes what's lost, I think, in politics or for anybody in the public eye. You know, sports people, entertainers. I think we sometimes forget that there's an actual human being there with human emotions, just like everybody else.
I mean, you've had to wear this yourself, Iain. I'm sorry to remind you of it, but you were sacked from your role because of a relationship with a former staffer. What is it like to live through a scandal like that in such a public way?
Oh, it's torrid. It's tremendously difficult. And the only way I could deal with it was just to keep myself to myself, kind of go to ground, I suppose, for a while, spend time with my loved ones, help them deal with what was going on too, because it affects your family and your friends as well. But I was, you know, like I think was probably happening with Kiri, I had people who got around me, who took care of me, and we made a plan for how, you know, I could get through that and how we could get through it together and get to a point where I felt confident being back out in public again and talking to you, Maddie, and all those sorts of things. You can work through it, but it is torrid, it is hard, and you need good people around you to do it.
And now that you're out of it, Iain, where do you stand and what do you look back on in terms of the way that Parliament operates and the way that that system operates for people when they're in the mix of it?
Yeah, look, Parliament is brutal, and I don't think you'll ever completely get rid of that, because it is right that our elected representatives are held to account, and you know that you're going to live your life in the spotlight. But I think Parliament, it has improved since I first came in 2008. I saw a lot of changes, both for MPs and for staff in Parliament, but I think it's still got a long way to go, and I think this demonstrates that, you know, Parliament is not a place that's well equipped to support people's mental health. It's a very competitive, it's a very low trust environment, and people are on the lookout to see where others have tripped up and to expose that. I think Parliament does need to continue to find ways to improve, and political parties in particular need to look at how they support their MPs and create the environment where people can talk about their struggles, can be open about it, and not feel the pressure to come back if they've taken some time out, or not feel the pressure to kind of hide what's going on for them personally out of fear that that might have a negative impact on their career.
So then how much responsibility in this whole scenario falls on the Prime Minister's shoulders then? The opposition has leapt at the fact that this speaks to a question of judgment for the Prime Minister, because he allowed Kiri Allan to come back when she'd been so open about the mental health struggles that she'd been going through.
Well, first of all, I would caution all the other political parties to be careful about throwing stones in glass houses. We don't have to go very far back in history to see examples where maybe other leaders perhaps haven't supported their team that well. But I think we can perhaps have some empathy for Chris Hipkins himself. He did everything that I think he thought was right. He probably took some advice. He asked Kiri. We just have to look back at last week to see how well she performed around a justice announcement. All the signs were there that she was fit to come back to work. But underneath it all, you know, she wasn't. So I feel for Chris Hipkins, actually, because he had to make a call. He used all the evidence that he had to make that call. And, you know, obviously, Kiri wasn't ready to come back. And maybe part of that is that she felt the pressure to demonstrate to Chris that she was ready and to get back into the frame. So I think that's the discussion we need to have, is to give people the confidence to feel as though they can say, actually, no, I'm not ready. Can I just have a little bit more time to keep working on this?
But he has to wear that now, you know, and this far out from an election, this is just another scandal, another minister that he's losing, that he doesn't have to deal with. I was looking back under Chris Hipkins, Phil Twyford was demoted, Mika Whaiteri quit the party, Stuart Nash was demoted, Michael Wood resigned, and now Kiri Allan. How serious of a situation is this for Labor, this close to the election?
Yeah, I think there's no escaping the fact that this will have an impact. And it's, as you say, it's in the context of several other events leading up to this event this week. I just think there's no avoiding the fact that people do take leadership and kind of the state of the party into account when they're considering their vote. I would be very, very surprised if this doesn't have some impact on Labor's polling. We've seen National struggle to pull away despite an environment where the opposition should really be thriving. But as you say, this is another nail in the coffin. I don't think it's all over, but it makes it really, really hard. It's going to be a close election. The tiniest little thing could swing it one way or the other. And it would be very, very surprising if this didn't provide a small swing towards the right.
And where to now for Kiri Allan herself? Obviously, her role as a minister, especially a justice minister, is untenable, but can she remain in Parliament at all? Or should she remain in that environment?
I think that's a decision she has to make. It was certainly a decision that was left to me. I was given the option whether I should go completely or stay on as an MP. I made the call pretty quickly that it was that I should call time on my political career, and I haven't regretted that once since then. I'm living a great life now. But look, that's for Kiri to decide. Others have made different decisions based on their personal experiences and their personal ambitions. And I hope Kiri takes a little bit of time to think about it and work out what is actually best for her.
Former Labor Minister Iain Lees-Galloway joining us live from Palmerston North. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks, Maddie.